An hoche pa, Bryant, Celestine, an ayiksa, ofata, mamo, an Alabama-Coushatta. Greetings, everyone. My name is Bryant Celestine. I'm from the ofata clan, the beaver clan, from the Alabama-Coushatta tribe of Texas. I want to thank Tom for inviting me. He's invited me a couple of months ago, and we put it on our calendar not knowing whether we would have the opportunity. We had another meeting scheduled back in September to meet with the National Guard in New Orleans, Louisiana, and unfortunately that fell apart, and they rescheduled that for earlier this week, so I wasn't sure whether I was going to attend either one of them, and so we worked it out so that I was able to not only go to that meeting but also to come here. So earlier this week, I spent a few days in Mobile, Alabama, and flew back last night and drove up this afternoon to be with you tonight. So it's kind of been a long week, but it's going to get even longer next week because I'll be in Georgia all week long. So these are things that I do on behalf of the tribe. I'm the historic preservation officer. My responsibilities to the tribe include meeting with federal agencies and talking about how some of their projects that they do would impact our tribal people, the things that we had left in some of our ancestral territories, whether they're burials, whether they're funerary objects, whether it was a trail, a village, or artifacts. Those are the things that I deal with on a daily basis on behalf of the tribe. So our tribal people come from 7 ancestral territories in the southeast, and that's a lot of area to cover. Not as much as some other tribes, but it's a lot of work when you're only a solo operation. So I deal with that on a daily basis. I not only meet with them, but I deal with thousands of letters and emails each year. Mostly, we've been averaging the last 4 years over 12,000 letters. So that's a lot of consultations that we do on behalf of the tribe. My other responsibilities to the tribe are giving presentations like you'll see tonight, making arrangements for doing other cultural exhibits. Sometimes we bring artifacts with us for demonstrations. We do that for some of our schools. Sometimes we bring out some of our dancers. And so we also have that responsibility on behalf of the tribe itself. We also deal with creating internal projects and programs for our tribal people. So we don't just deal with historic preservation, we also deal with cultural preservation and revitalization. We work really hard on making sure that our children have the opportunity to learn the language, to learn how to make the baskets. And we spend a couple of times a year working and trying to teach them a little bit about our history, whether it goes through our newsletter or for us to do presentations for them. So, of course, I'm from the Alabama-Coushatta tribe of Texas. We are one of 3 tribes within the state of Texas that are fairly recognized by the U.S. government. It has a history in itself and why we are one of the few tribes that are here today. However, there are tribal members within the state of Texas that are not as a tribal government. There's many Choctaw here in Dallas area. We have some in San Antonio and Houston area. We have Kiowa, we have Creek, we have Navajo, we have some natives from Alaska, we have natives from New York, some Seminoles. So just as you look into a city and see all the ethnic groups that are there, realize that there are additional ethnic groups that come from the Aboriginal inhabitants of this country. So tonight, he asked me to speak about our tribal people. He said I had 2 hours, so apparently I got an hour for each bottle here. But I wanted to talk about our history and our culture, to familiarize with you, because I know that most of you have probably never heard about Alabama-Coushatta. Most of you probably have heard of Choctaw or Creek, Cherokee, Navajo, and these are some of the largest tribes that we have in the country. But most people don't know about Alabama-Coushatta, and I'm honored to present that on behalf of my people, because without us giving these type of demonstrations, without giving us these presentations, that information would cease to exist, because on an annual basis, many schools throughout the country continue to eliminate that type of the history. Every single year we face this. So our Historic Preservation Office has a responsibility going to different schools, different colleges, and different audiences, just like tonight. I've done presentations for the State Attorney General in Austin, Texas. I've done some from the Tiguas in El Paso. I've also done programs for Fort Polk in Louisiana and Fort Benning several times in Columbus, Georgia. We've also done presentations for the Texas Department of Transportation, the Georgia Department of Transportation, the Alabama Department of Transportation. So the people that we deal with range in age. You know, we've even done some for small reading groups in libraries. So we have a diverse audiences that we present our information to, and we gear it to each individual groups. So sometimes it's just a general audience. It could be a room full of soldiers, or it could be a room full of doctors who have doctorates in archaeology and anthropology. And those are some of the hardest people to convince about a lot of our history. But I wanted to talk to you a little bit about our history. These slides are brief, and I'll try to explain them as we go along. In 1540, the Alabama or Hernando de Soto had came in through southeastern United States to not only claim territory but to find treasures for Spain. And so his responsibility was to go and conquer. And as his expedition had went through southeastern United States, they not only did those things, but they recorded the areas they went to and the tribal people they ran across. So we're very fortunate for that, or very literally fortunate for that experience, because it documented the Alabama and the Coushatta people in the 1540s. Because without that documentation, we would have a rough time trying to establish who we are. And a lot of tribes would have that same conflict. Because without having any type of documentation, the federal government would not recognize you as an Indian tribe. So we're while we have issues with Europeans coming onto into our homelands, we're fortunate just to have that documentation written. The Alabamas were first documented in 1541 in northeastern Mississippi and northwestern Alabama. We believe that they come from the Moundville culture, and from that Moundville culture would be those that would include the Choctaw and the Chickasaw people. We eventually had a falling apart, and all three of these tribes split. And so we have relationships still with those people, the Choctaw and Chickasaw. However, we did not get along for a couple of centuries. And as you can see on this map, which we found in the Texas State Archives in Austin, Texas, there's indication of where Alabama villages were in northern Mississippi. For the Coushattas, they were documented in 1540. We believe that they came from the Coosa Kingdom, which would have originated out of northern Georgia and southern Tennessee. They also had their own enemies amongst their own people from the Coosa Kingdom, the Creeks and Yamuchi, Yamasee, and the Yuchi. And so on this map that is the same from earlier, it shows where the Coushatta people were found. They were found along the Tennessee River on islands along the Tennessee River, not just in Alabama, but also in Tennessee itself. By the mid-1600s, both of these tribes had migrated into central Alabama, where the conflux of the Tallapoosa and the Coosa River is. And like you can see on this map here, it's a French map that indicates where the Alabama villages were. When they had moved into this area, they had forced a lot of the smaller Creek tribes out of that area into southern Alabama. And so when you talk with our anthropologists and archaeologists, they talk about this categorization of tribal people, an organization of the tribes within this territory. They would say that the Alabamas were part of the Upper Creek Confederacy, and we had some of these other tribes part of the Lower Creek Confederacy. So where you see this circle is, that was actually the dividing line between both of those groups. That doesn't, even though we have that moniker of being part of the Upper Creek Confederacy, we are not Creek people. So there is a distinct difference. In 1702, the French began landing into Mobile Bay, and as they came into that territory, they settled among their friends, the Choctaw. And because they were friends with the Choctaw, they became our enemies because we already had war with the Choctaw at that time. And so that was something that really ignited a lot of tension in that area. By a strange coincidence, that conflict ended by accident. At that time, and during that time period, our people were trading with the English people. And at this point, the English were starting to reduce the amount of rations they were trading with the tribal people. And so they continued that constantly because the tribal people were on a daily basis bringing in their skins, whether they were deer, raccoon, or whatever, they would continue to bring them in. And so they began to run out of supplies. And so one of the other things that they were forbidden to do was to trade any arms with certain tribes. And so our Alabama people turned around and asked the French, what will you give us for our furs? And so that actually started that friendship with the French people. And as a result of that, we allowed the French people to build Fort Toulouse in central Alabama next to Alabama and Coushatta villages. And this was the easternmost fort of the French east of the Mississippi River in southeastern United States. It was originally established to be a military stronghold. However, they didn't have a lot of soldiers, and most of the soldiers that they had didn't want to fight, and so it just became a trading center. So they used our tribal people to help negotiate a lot of the trade goods that were coming in. And so the other tribal people that were there, they would come and trade with the Alabamas, or they would trade with the Coushattas, and then we in turn would trade with the French people, and we would always help them get a better deal on what they were trading for. Once the French and Indian War was over, the Treaty of Paris and signed, that required that the French people give up all their territory east of the Mississippi River. And so they had began leaving central Alabama in 1763, and as they began leaving, they began to tell the chiefs that the English were coming, and the English were not nice people, that their intent was to destroy our people. And so as a result of that, our warriors had escorted them down all the way to Mobile Bay, and the French people were able to give some of those tribal people ferry service from Mobile into New Orleans. So some people started begin migrating that way. Others went back and told the people, we need to leave. And so some of those tribal people started coming down towards the coast, and they would go all the way down down the coastline to get into Louisiana. We had others that tried to go through central Mississippi. However, they would run into Chickasaw tribal warriors and would be forced back into Alabama. So over time, we had some factions that would stay in Alabama, and others that ended up going into central or into Louisiana itself. Some of those that returned to Alabama found that it was easier to join other tribes. Some of them ended up joining the Creek nations, others joined Seminole nations. And even if any of the warriors that did, they were used in those Creek and Seminole wars that they had. Others decided that they were going to continue on, and so they would go down to the coast and they would actually island hop. They would take their canoes and actually island hop from Alabama into New Orleans, into St. Bernard Parish. So by 1838, those that were remaining in the state of Alabama were forced into Oklahoma on the Trail of Tears. The Indian Removal Act forcibly removed all of these tribal people at gunpoint, at knife point. And so the relatives that we left there, the Alabamas and the Coushattas that were left over there, they became part of this Trail of Tears. And so today there is an Alabama-Coushatta tribal town of Oklahoma. They are still our relatives. We still share that history with them. However, because they've been in Oklahoma so long and because of the larger Creek Nation that's there, a lot of their culture has assimilated into that Creek culture. So their language that they speak comes from, is the Muskogean language, it's the Creek language. A lot of the practices they do are still Creek in nature. However, they still do some of the traditional stomp dances. When we went into Louisiana, the commandant of New Orleans actually gave the tribe 2 leagues of land, 1,280 acres. However, our tribal people never took possession of any of that territory. They began to move from eastern Louisiana into western Louisiana and eventually migrated into northwest Louisiana into Caddo and Bossier parishes. And here was where they met the Caddo people. And that began several decades of friendship. This actually helped the Caddo people. When our folks had moved in that territory, the Caddo people would invite our tribal people to go hunt with them. And so they would go into over here into north eastern Texas, and they would go and hunt buffalo together. One night, some of these Coushatta warriors were out on a hunting party, and they decided to camp overnight. And they were real quiet, and they could all of a sudden they could hear some hooping and hollering. All of a sudden they could hear this thunderous noise, and so they sneaked out of camp to see what was happening, and realized that these Indians had a bunch of horses. Hundreds of horses, really, and wondered what was going on. And because they had so many horses with them, they had to stop. And so the people, the Coushatta warriors, recognized the Indians as not being from that territory. They realized that they were Osage. They also realized the horses belonged to their friends, the Caddo people. And so they snuck up on that camp and were able to recapture some of those horses and bring them back to their Caddo people and to the Caddo friends. By the 1790s, Coushattas began to run across the Sabine River, began settling in different villages, going as far as the Trinity River. The Alabama soon followed suit and started settling along the Trinity and the Angelina and the Neches Rivers. By 1803, while each of these had settled three camps or three villages, they also established a network of trails. It allowed them to get from village to village, not only here in the state of Texas, but also to the villages that they left in Louisiana. And if you look at the top green mark that comes down, that actually connects to the El Camino Real de los Tejas. The one that goes across was called the Coushatta Trace. The Coushatta Trace had a lot of significance, not only in our history, but in the settling of Texas. And where its starting point is actually in Maryville, Louisiana. And this map will show you that it goes to Columbus, Texas, from the, I think it's the Brazos River. This map shows a general migration from Alabama into Texas. Had there been interstates back then, this is how much mileage it would take. 637 interstate miles from central Alabama to where we are in Texas today. What's significant about this number is it's a lot higher, and this was done by foot. So that's a long journey to be made, bringing their foods, bringing some of their livestock, bringing the tools that they needed, the foods that they needed, and bringing their families over. So I like to share this with kids because sometimes they don't understand that it's a long journey. They're accustomed to riding in a vehicle and somebody else is driving, and they're playing on their iPads or playing on their cell phones or whatever. But back then, that wasn't the case. It was 637 miles, had it been interstate miles, in a straight shot. However, our people didn't go in a straight path. So this would have been the minimal number of miles that it would have taken our people. afraid of U.S. Expansion, Spanish Mexico began inviting our tribal people, not only just our tribal people, but other tribes to move into the Sabine River territory. This was a means to protect the Spanish territory from the oncoming American people. And so a lot of these tribes took that opportunity, the Creeks, the Cherokees, the Choctaw, Biloxi, Tensaw, some Seminoles. Some decided they liked it here, some didn't, so they turned around and went back. So there was a numerous amount of tribes coming into the territory at that time. Our tribal people are documented at trading with the Atascocita Post down in Liberty County and also the Nacogdoches Post here in Nacogdoches, Texas. These posts had enlisted our tribal people to help them patrol some of the trails that were coming through. They wanted to know which settlers were coming in, what Indians were coming in, and kind of what they were bringing, because the Spanish government did not want contraband coming into this territory. So they would trade and give us more goods for providing intel on any of that infiltration that was coming in. During the Battle of Rosales with the Mexican troops versus the Spanish troops, our Coushatta warriors participated in that battle. There were several that were there, and they were invited to help with the armies. And as the Mexican forces and the some of the early Texas settlers that were coming in, they all got together and decided they were going to do a battle plan. And the Coushatta people didn't really know English or the Spanish language, so they had no idea what they were being told. And so they saw the Spanish people forces coming over the hill, and without warning, these warriors took off and just started running towards the enemy. So you had these Texas settlers, and you had these Mexican forces turn around and realize, hey, our help is gone. They've already joined the battle. So they followed them, and the Spanish warriors Spanish forces had no idea what the battle plan was, so they turned around and left. And so because of that, our warriors were cited for bravery. During the Texas Revolutionary War, both sides had asked our tribal people to stay out of the war. So while we had warriors there, they were not participating in battle. They were scouts. As a result of that neutrality, we had the Cherokee chief, Chief Bowles, come and demand our people to join the battle. We also had Comanches coming in to force our people to fight. However, our Coushatta warriors had met them in the valley of the Long King Creek in Polk County and chased those warriors away. And those warriors never came back. And so we were kept safe by all these things. Now, a moment ago, I said how significant the Coushatta Trace was. There was a little event that was associated with the Texas Revolutionary War called the Runaway Scrape. This event was actually at a moment's notice. When these battles went from the battlefield to the plantations to the ranch houses, these families were not prepared. And so at a moment's notice, they got up and left. They couldn't take their medicines. They couldn't pack their groceries. They couldn't pack a suitcase. They just got up and left. They grabbed the children and left. They grabbed their elders and left and tried to make their way into Louisiana, where it was safe territory. And so the only way that they knew was by going east. Well, lo and behold, they ended up going on to the Coushatta Trace. Going through that Coushatta Trace, they ended up getting across the Trinity River and finding our tribal people waiting there. And of course, their experience with tribal people was not very satisfactory. And so these settlers were afraid. However, our people welcomed them. They brought them into the villages and they fed them. They gave them medicines. They fed their horses and they fed their kids. If the children got lost, they went and found them. And so they escorted them into Louisiana and kept them safe that whole time. And so this runaway scrape was part of that trail, the Coushatta Trace. And even this particular event was beneficial to our tribal people. After the war, all the land grants that were previously established were nullified. And so it had an open range policy, and so folks began to claim territory that they had never seen. Folks from Georgia, North Carolina, New York, Tennessee began to file for land here in the state of Texas. Whether it was one league or two leagues, you know, they did what they could, and as a result of that, our tribal people lost the land that they were living on. Both Alabama-Coushatta were forced off those lands, even though they established themselves. They built their villages, they built their fences, and they planted their crops. They had to abandon all those things. Sorry, I got lost. The state, the Republican legislature actually granted one league to the Alabama people. And when they came to actually survey that property, the tribal people were so accustomed to being forced on the land, and they saw these folks coming in with equipment, they just turned around and abandoned that property, even though it was meant for them. And because they had left, somebody else acquired that property on the spot. So they began to continue moving around from place to place. There were several occasions where not only the government, but the presidents worked to find land for the tribal people, beginning with Sam Houston, who was a dear friend of the Alabama-Coushatta people. During the war and after the war, he always met with our chiefs. He came to our reservation to come and talk with us and met council under a huge oak tree that was in front of our Presbyterian church. And so we had great relationships with Sam Houston. However, it didn't ever come to play. Every time that legislation came out for land, it was already gone. Somebody had already claimed it. As a result, both the tribes continued to migrate from place to place. Unfortunately, with other tribes that were in the state of Texas, they became hostile. They began attacking other villages. They would attack plantations and homes, and they would take hostages. They would take the treasures and the livestock. That didn't help our people because it portrayed all Indians as being hostile. That also began to happen to us, to our people, where settlers began to attack our villages and try to take the things that we had away from us. As a result of that, President Maribel Lamar had to issue legislation demanding the settlers to leave our people alone and actually instituted criminal action against those that would take action against our tribal people. This was very significant because Maribel Lamar did not like Indians, was a staunch opponent. His policy was exterminate or removal. And so a lot of, as Tom had mentioned earlier, the three tribes that are fortunate to be within the state, the other tribes had to face this this action from Maribel Lamar. However, we were the only exception to that. Why? Remember a few minutes ago I mentioned the runaway scrape? Some of his family were part of those people that came through that area. So he knew who our people were. He knew that we weren't hostile. He knew that we were here to help. And so because of that, he was willing to help our people. When the state received their statehood in 1845, they brought several people over time to become Indian agents to watch over tribal people. In 1854, 1,280 acres was given to the Alabama people as a reservation. This consisted of two leagues at that time, two leagues of land. In that time, 640 acres or one league was meant for a family of four. So 1,280 acres would consist of two leagues, and two leagues would stand for a family of eight. We had 1,000 people. So that land really wasn't sufficient enough. And I talked to gentleman, and I talked to Tom earlier this evening before we came in, and they remarked how beautiful it is in our area and how pristine it is. When we got that land, it wasn't that way. It was junk. It was trash. The people that owned that land couldn't make any use of it. They couldn't graze their cattle. The horses couldn't use it. They couldn't use it to grow their crop. It was all thick and bottomland. They call it the Big Thicket. So in the Big Thicket, from this point to this point is as far as you can see. So imagine trying to build your farm on property that you can only see not even 6 foot. So they turn around and sold it to the state, and the state gave it to us as a reservation. The Coushattas had remained homeless. They moved from place to place, and they eventually were allowed to stay on some plantations as long as they would help with the plantation work. So some did decide to do that. Others decided that they were going to move on to the Alabama reservation at the permission of the Alabama people. Others decided that they didn't want to do plantation work and they didn't want to come to the reservation, and so they moved back into Louisiana because they had left some of their kinfolk over there. And this is the reason why there is a Coushatta tribe of Louisiana. Since independence, various legislations have tried to control the Indians that were in the state of Texas. They also tried to remove our people, despite the work of Sam Houston and Mary Beau Lamar. However, they worked on enacting legislation that would not only prevent that, but should it happen, it would require our tribal approval. And so every single legislation that exists on moving our people from any place required our tribe to approve that. There was one last attempt to move our people up into Young County. This was where the Lower Brazos Reservation was established for all the tribes in the state of Texas. And so our tribal people, of course, needed to make that approval, so our chiefs went up to that territory, coming in from East Texas all the way into Young County. While they were visiting that territory, they understood what was happening, that change was coming. Where Young County was not like Polk County. It was not like Elmore County in Alabama. Where we are today, there's millions of trees. Everywhere you look, there are trees. But in Young County, there's very few trees. There's a lot of prairie land. And so our people that went up there knew that our people couldn't survive on that type of land, on that type of soil. And so they refused to move. And because of that refusal, you know, because we were required to approve that, the state had no choice but to allow us to stay. What was also fortunate about that was that on our way back, a camp of Indian women and children on that reserve were attacked by their neighbors. They killed every woman and every child that was in that little camp. As a result of that, the state took all those tribes and moved them into Oklahoma. So that's the reason why you didn't have all these tribes still staying in this territory. However, you know, we were permitted to stay, but also the state of Texas withdrew having an agent over the Indian people. This was significant because we had no tribal government or any type of governance over the tribal people from this time period until the 1900s. Early 1900s. So we've always had an agent at that time. There was, you know, different folks that came in to help our tribal people, and they would report to the state or report to the different governments. But once that agent was gone, there was no other help that was provided to our tribal people. During the U.S. Civil War, our folks had, our warriors had joined the Confederate side. They were trained as cavalry because they were good horsemen. And so they were trained as cavalry. Their original commander had left, and so they brought in a new commander, and he took the forces over into Arkansas to join the unit there. And the general of that unit only wanted his infantry or his cavalry to be the only cavalry. So he dismounted all the other cavalry that were coming in, including the Alabama-Coushatta warriors. They became disgruntled and refused to do the soldiers' work. They would sit all day long. They would mumble and grumble until finally the general had enough and discharged all those warriors. And so they came back, actually, back to the homelands here in Texas and re-enlisted. And when they re-enlisted, they were trained to build flat-bottom boats, rafts, over here in Anderson County. And so they would build those rafts, and they would take those rafts and put them on the Trinity River, and they would start taking supplies from North Texas all the way down to Liberty. This was significant because at that time, the Union forces had Galveston Island blockaded. Because of this action, the Confederates were able to free Galveston Island. So all those supplies, you know, made it to where it needed to go because our tribal people knew the Trinity River. They were able to take all these military supplies, the ammunition and foods that they needed to help free that blockade. One of those warriors that was part of the force was John Scott. He eventually became one of our tribal chiefs and lived to be 109 years old. After the war, we found out that 110 acres was actually taken away from us by mistake. Even though we were granted 1,280 acres, surveyors came out and surveyed the land to make sure that they had the right dimensions. However, one of those pages did not make it into the official records, and so that particular parcel of property was given to somebody else. We didn't know about it until we tried to fence our own lands. And so because of that, we ended up losing 110 acres. At this time, we had a Presbyterian minister named Reverend Tenney trying to make his way from Tyler into Beaumont. Being his first time in this territory, he got lost. And of course, as I said, the big thicket is really thick. So he had no idea where he's going, and he got lost and fell sick. Fortunately, there was a group of Alabama hunters in that woods at that time. They found him, brought him back to the reservation, gave him medicine and gave him foods, and they helped heal him. And so once he gained his health, they escorted him into Beaumont. And from Beaumont, he came back to Tyler and to Crockett and began to advocate for having a church established on the reservation. As a result of that, in 1880, the Presbyterian Church was established outside the reservation. It allowed for not only a church, but a home for missionaries and a small school building. So missionaries were sought to come in and be caretakers and teachers for our tribal people. The first of those was the Curry family. They were there for a short time. There were some issues that came up, and so they left. They were eventually replaced by the Chambers, who consisted of actually of a doctor and a teacher. And so there, we were very fortunate to have the Chambers come to our reservation. What wasn't fortunate was that they came in with the philosophy of Americanizing our people. As a result of that, the ceremonial fires that we brought from Alabama, from our homelands, had to be extinguished. Any of the traditional dances, including the stomp dances, were forbidden. The matrilineal methods that were opposed was not in line with biblical terms. In biblical terms, the man is the head of household, and they direct how things go. Our tribal people that come from the Southeast were matrilineal. Everything comes from our mother. As I said, as I introduced myself, I said I was from the Beaver clan. I'm from that clan because of my mother. She was Beaver. My dad was a Deer clan. But our people believe that the mother was the giver of life. As a result of that, we, as tribal people, had a high opinion of the women, of the mothers. So if the woman gave birth, she had high status in the tribes, and so she was the clan, each of the mothers were clan mothers. They also helped decide who was going to be the representative of all the tribal people. So they chose the tribal chiefs. The women were the head of the household. You could not marry into your same clan. You had to marry outside your clan. If you married inside your clan, you were marrying your brother and sister. And so you, once you married outside the clan, you had to marry into your wife's family. So the husband would leave his clan to go into her clan. I'm sure some of these women would like to hear this, but because of that, all the property belonged to the women. The house, the land, the children, all the assets they had, it belonged to the mother. So if they had a divorce, the man got kicked out. So the men had nothing until they moved back into their own clans. The student speakers that spoke the traditional language was also punished. They were often ostracized during class. They were spanked. Sometimes they had their mouth washed out. And so there was a very strict regimen for our people to abandon many of our traditional ways. At this same time, our neighbors did not want us to be educated. And so they began to conduct many hostile acts. They would take their fences down that was adjacent to our reservation that was near our livestock. And when our cattle and horses and pigs would go across that fence, they would put that fence back up. And once that fence went back up, they would tell our people, because this is my property and those are on my property, they belong to me. They also began to burn our crop fields, whether it was corn, whether it was wheat, whether it was beans, or whether it was cotton, they would come in and burn it. They also went as far as burning down the church and the school building and the missionary's house. The folks that weren't opposed to us cried for help, seeking some sort of action against these people. However, our people never did declare for vigilance. In 1914, attorney named Clem Fain Jr. began a letter campaign to the federal government demanding help for our tribal people. Since that 1859, there was no type of government assistance given to our people. Even the federal government recognized that they had no records dating to 1859 about our tribal people. And so the Department of Interior commissioned Commissioner Locker of the Department of Interior to go and explore the status of the Alabama Indians. And so for the first time, we had a representative from the federal government come to our lands and actually do a census of our tribal people. He went back to the federal government, and when he presented his report, it was accepted. And the federal government said, yes, they need help. Yes, you know, they're dying off. Yes, you know, they need food, they need medicines, but we don't have any money. Why? That date, 1914, that was the beginning of the World War I. In 1929, Charlie Martin Thompson, actually 1928, Charlie Martin Thompson was elected tribal chief. He became Miccosukee, and he took a delegation of tribal members and local advocates to Washington, D.C. to advocate for help. He brought an interpreter with him. They met with congressional committees. They also got to speak on the floor of Congress to plead for help. When they were done, President Hoover invited them to the White House to come speak with him. And so, even though we came from nowhere, these folks wanted to speak with us and hear what we had to say. As a result of this visit, $32,000 loan was given to the tribe. This was supplemented by the state of Texas by $40,000 as well as a loan. They used this money to purchase seeds, to buy better homes, to build a school, to build an administration building, and to purchase additional 3,041 acres. When that deed was written out, it was written out to the Alabama and Coushatta Indians of Texas. That was the first time those two tribal names were put together as one moniker. As a result of not only this visit, they were able to establish a school district on our reservation. So at one time, we had the reservation school district. Teachers came in and trained our students to be athletes. They became good basketball players and went to play local community schools and played really well and defeated a lot of teams. A lot of these schools, bigger schools, realized how what great athletes we were, and so they advocated through the state of Texas to cease funding to our schools. And so in 1948, our students were forced to go into either Livingston, Woodville, or a small community called Dollarsville Big Sandy. In 1954, the federal government relinquished its responsibility over the tribe. We were fortunate at that time the state of Texas stood up and said that they were willing to take on that responsibility. However, when they did take that responsibility, they put the tribal people into what was called a Board of Special Schools. It had another name, but that was the main name of it, was the Texas Board of Special Schools. This is where they lumped all the insane asylums and the deaf schools and the mental hospitals. And so that consideration made us wards of the state. Beginning in the 1960s, the state of Texas began to issue the tribe loans. This was for self-sufficiency, to bring economic enterprise to the tribe. And so we began to establish different types of tourism programs, beginning with different tours, a museum, a gift shop, and they also built a 26-acre lake for camping. They built a museum and a dance square to demonstrate some of the tribal lifestyles. And they also built a convenience store with a modern laundromat. Over time, they began to expand these operations. They instituted building a train track for a small steam engine train. They also established a separate gift shop, a reptile garden, and also a restaurant. They also built an outdoor amphitheater that would portray the story, or not the story, but a story of how we not only came into Texas, but how we were able to stay within the state of Texas. That story was called Beyond the Sundown. They also built a pottery plant to compete with a lot of the pottery that was coming out of the southwestern part of the country, from the Navajo and the folks that come from the southeast. There were downfalls to all this. A lot of our folks objected to having foreigners on our tribal lands. They also objected to having a lot of these activities as not being tribally authentic. The dances were not ours. The outdoor play was fictional because it really didn't tell the true story. And the pottery was mass production. They would take these casts and they would pour the clay in there, and then they would bake it, and then they would design it afterwards. So they were not traditional pottery. The recession of the 70s and early 80s also had a detrimental effect. And so a lot of the activities had to be shuttered down or downgraded. We began to have conflicts with the state. And in 1981, before I get to 1981, a lot of decisions that had to be made by the tribe had to go through what was called the Texas Indian Commission. Before, it was called the Texas Committee of Indian Affairs. This was the state's agency having governance over all the tribal people within the state of Texas. And so any decision that our tribal council had made or our tribal administrator made had to be approved by that commission. And so when they didn't get along, the council sought to remove a lot of these folks, even sending petitions to the governor. In 1981, two of our tribal members were cited for hunting without a state license and out of season. One of these, the first individual lived right next to the highway. The game warden came by, saw him dressing the deer in his front yard, came in, gave him a ticket, and he objected and said, "Why are you giving me a ticket?" So the older guy down the road's got one too. So he went to go see the older guy, and sure enough, he's skinning the deer. So he issued him a ticket. It went through the local courts, justice of the peace. The JP said, this is ridiculous. I don't know where the law stands, so he threw out the citations. However, both of those citations, the Texas Game Warden pushed it all the way to the state attorney general's office, where they ruled that the tribal lands must adhere to the state laws. One of those individuals that were cited, the older gentleman, actually became one of our chiefs. In 1983, the attorney general had ruled that the state of Texas could not endorse any type or provide any programs for any type of ethnic group based on their ethnicity or their culture. What that really meant was that the state of Texas could not recognize any Indians just because they were Indians. So as a result of that, the state declared there were no Indians within the state boundaries of the state of Texas, and that ruling still stands today. What's significant about that ruling was that the state of Texas issued a tax bill to the tribe for over 40 years of non-payment for mineral rights, for timber, for land taxes. And so the tribe had turned around and sought for reinstatement of federal recognition through the federal government. So beginning in 1983, all the way to 1986, this went to the Congress floor. And the state senator at that time recognized this was an open bill and was able to derail the congressional vote. That senator was U.S. Phil Graham. The reason why it was derailed was because the state of Texas did not want any type of gaming within its state boundaries. In 1987, we were finally able to get President Reagan to sign a public law 100-89. This provided recognition to the Isleta del Sur Pueblo in El Paso and also the Alabama-Coushatta Tribe of Texas. This legislation, it's a federal legislation that required both tribes not to pursue any type of gaming that was not endorsed by the state of Texas. What was significant about that recognition, it also threw out that tax bill of 40 years of non-payment. So these slides are going to go through a little bit of some of our historical photos that we have in our tribal archives and others that we've collected over the years from different folks or photographs that we've taken. They're about our tribal people. They're about our tribal reservation. They're about some of the events that have gone for the tribe, some of the activities we continue today. Since 1987, it's not been an easy battle. Our tribe tried to every attempt to for economic stability. Unfortunately, a lot of folks had lost interest in coming and visiting our tourist enterprise. It became a generational gap. They would come as children, they would come as parents, and then they would come as grandparents. And so we lost a lot of audiences that way. And so over time, and because of the expenses continued to mount, our tribal people had to shut that down. Once they shut it down, they decided that they wanted to pursue gaming. And so in 2001, for 11 months, the tribe of Alabama-Coushatta tribe had established a casino on the tribal lands. Because of that legislation, 100-89, that prohibited us from engaging any type of gaming that was not endorsed by the state of Texas, the Attorney General was successfully able to go through the federal courts and shut it down. However, at that time, we were working with different lobbyists to change the law and to help us. But we didn't realize that we were also paying for our enemies, because those same folks were paying the same lobbyists to prevent us from getting that gaming. I'm sure some of you have heard of these folks, but these folks all the way went into the White House itself. So if you can recall in the last 10 years of folks going to prison or being kicked out of the White House, It was because of that action itself. But in 2011, during its operation, we were bringing in a profit of $1 million a month. It didn't just benefit our tribal people. The town of Livingston and the community of Woodville was full. You could not get a hotel room from Sunday to Saturday. It got to the point where you almost had to make reservations just to go to McDonald's. That's how busy we were. We had folks coming in from different areas all over the state because we had gaming. And, you know, it worked really well. However, we had to shut those doors. And when we went to pursue action against those that that wronged us in that lobbying effort, we took that money and we put it into our education scholarships. So from that time up until about 2 years ago, we used that money to support our tribal people into education. Before I came on board in 2008, the tribe had met as a community and decided their long-term goals. And of the five, they earmarked three of them, the first being education, the second being employment, and the third being culture. On the education side, we were able to take that and fund our students. We were one of the highest tribes that paid our students every month to go to college as a non-gaming tribe, one of the highest. Each semester, we were able to pay $7,000. That's a lot of money for not having gaming. So we continue to support our kids every single day. We provide them as much scholarship, as help as they need. We take them and we show them some of the processes that they need, and we continue to counsel them so that they can get better at in their education. When I went to college in 1993, I was probably one of seven people that went at that time of our tribal membership. This past fall, we were able to send over 33 students to college. So we're very big on education. Our tribal chiefs are very big on education, and they stress that upon our tribal council to make sure that we provide for those students and that we continue to support them in all their education, not just in college, but in high school as well. We, you know, take a program called Johnson O'Malley, and we use that to encourage our school children to do better in their high school. We provide them a math tutor because math is one of the hardest subjects for our Indian students. So we spend a lot of time working on that. Because we had to close some of these facilities, we didn't have a lot of employment. Just recently here in June, we opened Nuskila Gaming. Before it was called Nuskila Entertainment, but today we call it Nuskila Gaming. This is a class two electronic bingo gaming. This is something that we were able to take to the Department of Interior and say, the state of Texas has bingo operations within the state boundaries. Does this give us the right? And the Secretary of the Interior said yes and issued our tribal people a permit. They went to the National Indian Gaming Commission and said, the state of Texas offers bingo. Does that give us the right to have a permit? And NIGC, National Indian Gaming Commission, said, yes, here you go. So since then, we've been operating Nuskila Gaming on our tribal lands. We've had a lot of folks come through our territory to visit because they don't want to go across the Sabine River and support those people over there, because that's a lot of money that comes in and out the door. When we had the Super Bowl here a couple of years ago in Dallas, they had buses lined up at the airport to take folks into Shreveport or Bossier City or into Oklahoma. And so even as they got off the plane, they were seeking to take that money out of the state. We are working to keep that money within the state, to not only benefit our people, but to the local communities and to the people that are here. Because we don't just employ our tribal members. More than 50% of the folks that work in that enterprise are non-Indian. So it doesn't just benefit us, it benefits those people. And the folks that, you know, win a jackpot, they may go out to Vegas, they may go out to Florida, they may go somewhere for vacation, but the majority of what they win is going to be spent right here in the state of Texas. And so we're very fortunate to have that enterprise working for our people. Today, we have our tribal council. We have seven members that are elected to three-year terms on a staggered basis. So each year, there's at least two tribal council members that are elected to the council. This year, we have three that are up for election. And each year, once that election has been completed, the tribal membership once again goes to the election to decide who's going to be the chairperson for the tribal people to speak on behalf of the tribe. And so once that person's decided, then the tribal council reconvenes and they decide who's going to be the second in command, the vice chair, the secretary, and the treasurer. We still have our tribal chiefs. We have a principal chief and we have a Mikosi, the second chief. Both of these folks are elected for life. So even though our tribal government is under the jurisdiction of the tribal council, we still pay homage to our traditions by having tribal chiefs. When they were two separate tribes, the Alabama and the Coushatta, they each had one chief. And so because we're now one tribe, we still have those two chiefs. They're advisors to our tribal council. And so every time the tribal council meets, they're there. They offer their opinion. And if there's a tie, then they get to cast a tie-breaking vote. As I said, our tribal chiefs are elected for life. We had one chief that was elected at the age of 26 back in 1936, and he served for 58 years. So that was a lifetime of service just for him. The gentleman that replaced him was one of the folks that was cited for hunting without a hunting license, and he passed away here in 2013. So we've had very few changeover for our chiefs beginning in 1936. And I think that's about does on for our history and our culture. You saw some of the baskets that are on there. We continue that tradition for our tribal people. It's called the longleaf pine needle baskets. If you've never seen a longleaf pine needle, it's usually about that long, about 12 inches. We have to go to certain areas to collect them, and we teach our people how to make those baskets. We just had a class here this past Monday night for 17 students. They're required to attend every single class. They're required to take their work home and do some progress on it there, because when they come to class, they have different objectives instead of using the class time just to make the basket itself. So we continue those practices. We work every single year to establish language workshops and different programs such as our cultural camp to help institute a lot of these cultural practices, especially the language. When we have these events, the students that come in, whether they're adults, whether they're kids, or whether they're staff members, they're not allowed to have cell phones out at any time. And so it breaks their concentration. If you're a teacher and you have your cell phone out, the students are wondering why they don't have their cell phone out. So, or why they can't have their cell phone. So we prohibited a lot of that stuff because it's an opportunity for interaction. So our kids do learn from this. In February this year, I hosted one of these workshops for our high school and younger kids. We had 24 students. And by supper time, two of those kids got sick. However, they refused to go home. Their parents came to pick them up. Their guardians came to pick them up. They said, no, just bring me extra clothes. I'll be fine. So we're fortunate that we're instilling ambition to these kids. And so it's a lifetime work. However, we're not afraid of it. We do get criticized for not doing enough. However, you know, we're limited because it's just myself and one other staff member. As I described before, what my responsibilities are, my staff member is dealing specifically with cultural programs and helping me with doing presentations all throughout the year. So again, I want to thank Tom for allowing me to come. I'll thank the Allen Public Library for having me here. I'm pretty sure I put some of y'all to sleep, but you know, I did my job.
Are there any other tribal members of any tribe here tonight besides our Choctaw friends? Anybody? Questions, comments, protests. This is the time, this is the library. You can say what you want.
Hello, that was a very interesting presentation, and I have several questions. I'll just mention three. Can you tell me about the symbology on your flag, what they represent? And secondly, the young people that go to college, do they come back with ideas on how to reinvest in the tribe? Do they come back home and help create some new ideas to supplement the income for the tribe?
Okay. Regarding your first question, the logo that's there actually comes from pottery found at Moundville. As I, you know, started this presentation, I mentioned that the Alabama people originated from the Moundville culture. If you look in on a map of Alabama, and you look on to northwestern Alabama, you'll find Tuscaloosa. Just south of there is a huge mound complex called Moundville. This complex is several hundred years old. They know that there are several different groups that originated out of there. The folks that we know that came out of there, of course, were the Choctaw, Chickasaw, and Alabama. So they were related in that form. So this logo comes from pottery that was found over there during an archaeological survey. Our people adopted that logo. And today what it means is that, you know, the two heads that you see there represents the two chiefs that we do have. The four spears that emanate from the center, those represent everything of four. The four phases of the moon and the four directions. In the very center, you see a circle with a curved line in the middle. That represents, one side represents the Alabama, the other side represents the Coushatta people. Because we're one tribe today, even though we were two separate tribes, we're one today. The seven feathers that emanate from the center, they represent our tribal council members today because we have seven leaders. So it's been adopted over the years and altered. However, that is our logo, and it has been trademarked for the last, I believe, 5 years. Regarding your question on our tribal or our college graduates, we do have some that do come back to the tribe. I myself have been fortunate to get a degree from Texas State University and came back to the tribe to help. Unfortunately, I did come to help the tribe. I did get a bachelor's degree, Bachelor of Science in Criminal Justice. I came to help our people with law enforcement. However, they had their own ideas, and so when this job originally opened up, I signed up for it and was elected to that position. So in 1998, for a year and a half, I worked on behalf of the tribe to establish this program and to help with establishing the Alabama-Coushatta Tribal Archives. Once we began having issues with our tribal government, we decided that it was no longer fit for me to stay. So I left, I resigned, and went and did a little bit of work in furniture production. And from there, I did 8 years of retail, working my way into management. And once I left this position, there was only two successors. My first successor was there for almost 5 years before she had passed away. The second one had multiple responsibilities and couldn't handle the responsibilities, so the tribe opened up the opportunity. And fortunately for me, for that time, you know, the opportunity came up as well, so I came back to the tribe in 2008 to help our tribal people. Others have not been that fortunate. Because we don't have a lot of income coming in, because there's not a whole lot of employment opportunity, many of these tribal graduates do come to our reservation. They see the low pay, or they see no room for higher management, and so they do turn around and leave and go to other communities or other states where they have better opportunities. Eventually, over time, some of those do come back. So, you know, and they've been able to help us with us, not only in our government, but in our economics and our administration. We have one gentleman, he's actually related to me on my mother's side. He was actually an attorney here in Dallas for many, many years, several decades. And he finally decided he was tired of doing legal work here and moved back to the reservation. And for 3 years began to help the tribe establish tribal codes, legislative codes. Opportunity opened up for him to become a federal judge, and he took that responsibility and actually worked for the Federal Court of Social Security Administration in New Orleans. So he did, I believe, two terms over there before he finally decided to retire and came back to our tribal people. And so today he still provides his legal input. He is a U.S. veteran, and so we're honored to have him, you know, back into our community. His wife was my supervisor at one time. She's very supportive of our education. She was our tribal administrator for several years, left and came back, and today is our tribal council chairperson. So there are folks that do come back and do help our tribal people, and they do have an ambition to get our people out from the bottom of the barrel and into the limelight.
Okay, and my last question is your tribe represented at the Smithsonian American Indian Museum in Washington, D.C.?
Representation isn't how.
Your history presented there.
They do have artifacts, however, not necessarily specifically Alabama-Coushatta. When I went earlier this year to the National Museum American Indian, they had this exhibit called Treaties. And as I'd walked through there, I'd recognized a portrait that I had seen in Alabama, I think it was a year before, 2 years before, walking around in a museum in Alabama. And this portrait was actually of a Coushatta chief back in the 1600s and 1700s, actually 1700s. And so I knew that who that was, and so I did take a picture of that and presented it to our tribal council and said, we have minimal representation here. We do have our flag there as well. Now, we do also have many artifacts that are over there, not just within the National Museum of American Indian, but also Natural History Museum. When we did go in December, we did spend some time with the staff of the National Museum of Natural History. We did go through their collection and see a lot of the artifacts there. However, a lot of their laws are different from other laws that we have to deal with. And so there are some things that we would like to have back. However, it presents an obstacle for us because we have to establish certain parameters. And so even though they're not represented on exhibit, our artifacts are still there. Things from that were collected in the 1930s, photographs and music that was collected in the 1920s. So there's many, many documents there, many of our baskets still over there.
I used to work with the Hopis, and I know that their Kachinas stomped the earth so that it would rain. You mentioned stomp dances. What was the purpose, and what were the situations under which you had those dances?
It varied depending on the dance. A lot of the stomp dances were tributes to the creator. Many of these dances were in significance of certain animals. Sometimes they had the bear dance, sometimes they had the terrapin dance, horsepin dance. It varied from time to time, and they were done at certain times. I'm not all too familiar with all the dances, but they were done as a homage to the Creator, because we had always believed that there is one being that has provided us with all these things, a land that we can walk on, air that we could breathe, water that we could drink, medicines that grow to help our people, foods that are out there that we can collect to feed our people. And so a lot of these things, especially the dances, were homage to those things that the Creator had given to our tribal people. There were certain dances that had to be done a certain way. There were certain dances that had to be a certain time. And there were certain dances that only had to be performed by certain people. There's a story of one of the dances. As I mentioned, I'm from the Beaver clan. We have 12 clans today. There probably had been many more before the 1900s. But nobody remembers any of those. However, we still recognize 12 clans today. And as I said, you get your clan from your mother. When a mother is non-tribal, the children have no clan to collect. They have nothing to inherit. So today we call them the no-clan people. They're still tribal people, but because they have no clan, they're the no-clan people. We have two other clans, or of the 12 clans, we have two that are extinct. There's the Alligator clan and the Wolf clan. Because there was no survivors, that surviving women that married, those two clans are extinct. However, there is one story that we have of the Wolf clan. Back when they had their village in San Jacinto County, they decided that they wanted to do a dance that did not belong to them. And so they went out there one night and began performing this dance. They knew it belonged to our tribe, but it wasn't meant for them. Excuse me. So as they performed this dance, the story says that the witnesses that were there watched as the ground opened up and swallowed all these dancers and all the clan members that were sitting around the circle and swallowed them all up and closed them all up. And so the earth swallowed that whole Wolf clan. So that's the reason why we don't have any survivors today. And so there are specific dances that were meant for different people or certain times. And so we had to be very careful with those things. In the 1900s, that became a lost art for our people. Some of our elders still remember some of it, but not a whole lot enough for us to recapture the whole essence. And so we're working with other tribes to bring that back to our tribal people.
Any other questions, comments? Okay.
Did the United States treat all the other tribes as y'all got treated?
Sometimes worse. There's, you know, different policies for different tribes. Sometimes, you know, for example, the Choctaw people were forced out of their homelands out of Mississippi. Some of them moved into Louisiana, and once they got in Louisiana, some of them were forced to become American citizens, and those that didn't want to become American citizens were forced into Oklahoma. And so when I say this is forcibly removed, a lot of this was done at gunpoint. You didn't have time to pack your goods. You didn't have time to pack your clothes or your medicines or your food. You were told to move right then and there. You weren't given the opportunity to leave as a family. So if you were out there hunting in the field and your family was over here at the house, many times you didn't come together. You didn't know what they didn't know what happened to their relatives, their own family. Many of those people died on the way over. They didn't create cemeteries. They were buried right on the spot. So that was all done at gunpoint. When they moved into Oklahoma, it still didn't change. As the government continued to Americanize the Indian people, they took some of these Choctaw and they sent them to Chicago or all the way into California or into Texas to Americanize them, to get them away from their tribal people so that they could learn English and learn the American ways. And so that really still hasn't changed. We're still facing that battle today.
There was one question over here.
Right, okay. Front.
I have a question about how big is the tribe? How many people are involved in this tribe, and how large is it? And also, I would like to know if you participate in the government of Texas, the United States, of are you active as members of the community outside of the reservation? Okay?
Yes, ma'am. Here a couple of years ago, we altered our tribal constitution and bylaws. Beginning in 1924, the federal government finally recognized those tribes that were not given any allotments under the Dawes Act. They finally gave those those tribal people American citizenship. That was because many of those that were not American citizens could not participate in the World War I because they were not citizens. So our tribal people, our warriors, were not allowed to participate in World War I. So in 1924, they passed the Citizenship Act. We became American citizens. In 1934, the federal government decided they needed to pass legislation that required tribes to establish a government very similar to the United States government, where there wasn't one or two people in charge, that there was an executive branch and there was a legislative branch, and if necessary, a judicial branch. So in 1938, many of these tribes began establishing their own constitution. We did too. So in 1938, we enacted the tribal constitution and bylaws. And at that time, most of our folks were full-blooded members. And so that was a requirement to be a member of the Alabama-Coushatta tribe. You had to be four force, Alabama-Coushatta or Alabama-Coushatta. And that stayed on the books here up until about 4 years ago when we amended that. So today it's a quarter of either blood, and you also have to prove lineal descendancy. So today we have over 1,260 tribal members today. Less than half live on our reservation, the rest all throughout the country. Regarding, what was your second question again? I'm sorry.
Active in the community.
Oh, for political action, we still do not get along with the state of Texas. We continue to fight that battle today. As I mentioned, we open Noskila Gaming for economic development for our people, because the state of Texas sees that as gaming that they really haven't endorsed. They're working really hard to close that facility. So that's an ongoing battle today. In terms of how we interact with them, we continue to work with them. We continue to lobby. We have lobbyists in Austin. And we continue to support legislation that will open up any type of economic development for all the tribes within the state of Texas, all three tribes. So that remains an ongoing progress today. We continue to work with different organizations and also continue to lobby within the United States government. Because of some of the wrongs that our tribal people have faced, the federal court system has recognized there are damages that are owed to our tribal people. That was recognized in 2001, and today we still have not received any settlement from that whatsoever. So that remains ongoing. Where we are very fortunate that Woodville community, which is 16 miles away, their local dentist went and was elected to the U.S. Congress as a representative, and he's up for re-election today. The only fortunate side is that he's a Republican, and Republicans really have no support to the Alabama-Coushatta people. So that's something we continue to fight every single day, but we do have lobbyists there. We do support different organizations that fight for Indian rights all over the country.
So thank you for spending your time with us here this evening and educating all of us. You talked a lot about the history and the practice of welcoming outsiders in the early days. and then also showed beautiful photos of fancy dancers and powwow and things like that. I'm just wondering, is it appropriate for people to come and visit? And are there events that they can observe and enjoy, or is it more closed? Are people from the outside welcome to come to Livingston and spend time and get a little more immersed in the culture, or would you prefer to keep that private?
We do welcome people. One of the photos that you saw up there was the entrance to our main headquarters. There we have two signs that are erected that says welcome to, or this is the Alabama-Coushatta Reservation, and most folks will take that little route in there, and there's another little billboard up that says welcome, Ilochka, means welcome. So we do welcome visitors. And also at that entrance, there's a monument that was erected by the state of Texas that recognized the contributions of the tribal people and the lands that were that make up the reservation. And so that was given to us by the state of Texas. So those are the things that welcome our tribal people. We still have a convenience store, not full service gas station, but has a gas station, and as one of our economic enterprises, we do have smoke shops. We do have three smoke shops located, one on reservation, one north of Livingston, and one in the Houston metropolitan area. And so those are the things that we've relied upon for economic stability for the last several years. We continue to allow folks to come in because our Nuscula Gaming is on our main headquarters. It's open 24 hours a day, 7 days a week. So if you have an itch to do some bingo gaming, we have that open and available. There's also a restaurant there that serves really good food. You get your money's worth, I guarantee you that. We also have events throughout the year. There's some that are specifically for tribal members, and we do have others that are open to the public. Every first weekend in June, we have our annual powwow. We invite folks from all dancers from all over the country, and we get several hundred cars for the 2 days that we have it. It begins on a Friday night and ends on Saturday night. Usually, the last several years, I'm the first face most people see because I stand right at the front entrance as they pull in. So I know how many cars we get. I know how many people go in and out. And they get mad at me because I park them in where they don't want to park, but that's what you get. But, you know, we do have that first weekend in June. We also have our children's powwow the last Saturday of January. And that's, I think we're going on our 10th or 12th annual powwow for that. It's open to all the dancers, however, specifically meant for children to continue the dance practices, the powwow dances. This past year, well, last several years, we've had folks from Oklahoma, Louisiana, and Alabama. And this year, the folks from Alabama actually brought a chartered bus and brought their children over here to enjoy themselves for the weekend. We also have Lake Tom Bigby, as you saw the picture up there. It is open to the general public. We offer primitive camping to hookups to RV. We also have some cabins that are available for rent. And that's open year round. So it's very low cost. It's even lower than state park fees. And so if you have an RV or if you want to rough it, we've got the facilities there. It's a really nice lake. It's really nice and quiet. I spent many weekends there myself. So many folks will do go out there. And of course, we've modernized ourselves too. So we do have Facebook. We also have Twitter. So if you Google Alabama-Coushatta, those things will pop up. We also have our own website, alabamacoushattatribe.com.
I'm going to ask the final question. Two questions. Have the ceremonial fires been revived?
No.
My last question is, what is it to bring healing to the victimization of your nation? What would you like to see the state of Texas do to facilitate a healing process?
For me personally, it would be to accept who we are, where we come from, and to recognize the help that we provided for them to be established themselves. The many portions of this presentation refers to those aspects. The Coushatta Trace that I mentioned, where folks went over there, we originally established that trail to help our people to get from Louisiana to our villages in East Texas. That trail was also used by many of the settlers from the Austin colony to get from Louisiana into San Felipe. So that's the reason why that trail went from Livingston, Polk County, all the way to Columbus. So our folks have helped in the foundation for the state of Texas. From the Battle of Rosales to helping the citizens, to protecting those citizens, and not providing any hostile acts. Yeah, we could have done it. We chose not to do it. So, you know, we have a lot of contributions to the foundation of the state, and the state should recognize that and allow us to do what we need to do and to help us do that. And many times we have to go to the state and ask them for help. As a federally recognized tribe, it shouldn't be that way. It should be the opposite, because the state goes to the federal government and asks for funding. You know, we have that avenue as well. We have the resources. We do know folks in Congress. We do know folks in the White House. But a lot of those times they don't see that opportunity. They'd rather do it for themselves. So, it's going to take full recognition of who we are and what we're capable of and the opportunities that we can work together with.
Are the Alabama-Coushatta history, is it a required part of the Texas school curriculum?
No. It is in textbooks. However, as I mentioned, each year that the information that goes in the textbooks gets smaller and smaller. When my daughter was in, I believe it was in sixth grade, she had to take a Texas history and actually got in trouble with her history teacher because the textbook had a paragraph about that big about Alabama-Coushatta. And she says, no, it's not that big, it's humongous.
Good for her.
And continued to argue with him, and she got in trouble for it. But I did stand up for her, and I did stand up to the school district, and said, that's wrong. You don't punish a student for knowing.
Good for you. One more question back here. And this will be our last question. And then afterwards, you can go visit with Bryant and thank him for coming all those many miles to come here to visit with us tonight.
Has the state of Texas involved you in the economic development, which they help other cities? Has the state of Texas involved y'all in the development of economic participation with them?
With the state?
Yeah.
No. The enterprise that I mentioned for tourism on our reservation, that was meant for our tribal economic stability. Each one of those events that occurred were done through loans to our tribal people, so monies that we had to pay back. So really, you know, they really haven't done enough for us. You know, we've paid our debts. The loans that were given to us in the 1920s for the land and all that property, those have all been paid back. But in terms of promoting the state, no. There's a lot of folks that we run into in Southeast Texas, even to Beaumont and to the state line, that says, why isn't the state helping, or why isn't the state asking for your help? And, you know, the short-term answer is the state doesn't want us to succeed beyond where we are today. Hey,
Hallelujah!